This program has been presented as a 19th century women's fashion show. Well, it certainly is, as you can see with all the models here. But the purpose of the presentation is not solely to entertain, but to use these glimpses of daily life that you see here as a yardstick to measure just how far we've come in the past century. This is the sort of clothing women actually wore in the 19th century on a day-to-day basis. And they did a lot more work than we do today, a lot more physical work in the sense of laundry, scrubbing, beating rugs, things like that. And they were all done wearing garments very similar to these. You can tell an awful lot about people by the clothing that they wear. This is certainly true today, and it was true in the 19th century. And it was very important back then. People judged you by the quality of your clothing, whether it was silk, whether it was cotton. And they could learn a lot about who you were and how much money you had in particular. Now, the ideal woman in the 19th century would have probably participated in a family scene such as this. This is from Peterson's Woman's Magazine from 1858. And it shows the evening hymn. You note the pious theme and the very passive attitude of the women. I have another one here that I'd like to show you. The mother and child from the same issue. Notice the very childlike, sweet quality of the mother. That was the ideal woman at that time. Someone who was a mother, primarily. Certainly beautiful. Beauty was very important, just as it is today. Unfortunately, we're still feeding into that myth. But it was really all of a woman's worth at that time, how many children she had, whether she had children, how beautiful she was. In the 1850s and 1860s, clothing became extremely restrictive. I won't go into any of my opinions as to why. We could be here all day. But one of the worst things that ever happened to women in the 19th century was this little garment here. Actually, there were two, but this is one of them. This is the patent-adjusted skirt, or the hoop skirt. I have a model here, Kristen, who's been very kind to wear this outfit. I'd like you to step out. These were very dangerous. Out around so people can see. Can you get around? OK, go ahead. The point is being well made. Picture's worth 1,000 words. One of the worst things that could happen to a woman in a skirt like this was if you were around an open flame. That's pretty obvious. You imagine the type of houses people lived in back then, little colonial houses with small doorways and little tables with candles and lamps. You bump your skirt catches fire, and don't even think about getting out of it in time, because the fire would swoop up underneath all that air holding the skirt out, and you'd be dead before you knew it. An actual fact that sounds like it couldn't possibly be true, but as far as I can gather, it is. It was documented in a book written in 1919 by a man named Max von Bowen, who was considered an expert on fashion of the 19th century, that in Santiago, Chile, 2,000 women burned to death in the cathedral on December 8, 1863, because of skirts such as this. It's hard to imagine such a large number of people. They just couldn't possibly get out of the clothing in time, and the fire spread from skirt to skirt. Another real danger in a skirt like this is kind of humorous in a sick sort of way. People used to get blown over cliffs. Really. Imagine you're down on the beach. It's March. It's a lovely day. Spring's coming. You're admiring the ocean, and all of a sudden, a gust of wind comes under your skirt, and boom, you're over the edge. It really used to happen. Also, people got caught on the wheels of wagons, and they'd get dragged. And now you think, well, these were all rich ladies. They had people to run along behind them. But middle class and lower middle class women wore hoop skirts. This was the style. People wore it. And it's easy for us to say, oh, well, you know, why would they do that? The same reason why people go on diets when they don't need to, and people wear clothing with high heels today when they really, you know, it's not good for your feet. It was the style. And here you see in Paris, 1862, I apologize for the quality of these. These are from old photographs. You see these women, they're all working class women outside of a hoop skirt crinoline shop. And they wore them also. I have another picture here that I'd like to show you that is part of my theory as to why architecture changed so much. Of course, there are other reasons too. People's clothing was so ornate and so elaborate, they needed a new type of house to accommodate them. The small little colonial houses just weren't cutting it anymore. This is also from a Peterson's magazine, and here's another. And these houses would have probably actually belonged to people who would have been upper middle class. They weren't necessarily the extremely wealthy. It was a time of conspicuous consumption and great ornateness in many ways, and the clothing reflected it. This dress is not old, and those of you that might have thought it was, I don't want to mislead you. The collar is. I have a few things from the 1860s, but they're very frail. Most of the stuff that was saved was silk, because they would have been someone's best dress. And better quality silk tends to split with age. It had a lot of metal in it, and there's an acidic reaction that occurs, and it just splits to tatters. So I don't really have anything that could be worn. But Kristen was so very kind as to accommodate me. I wanted to show one thing here. I don't know if I can, because I'm electrified. But if you could imagine a lady like this walking beside another person on the street, the hoop skirt would go up. People considered them very immoral when they first came out, because you got this dreadful expanse of nether limbs exposed on the other side. Also, oddly enough, the only real beef that the morality crowd had with the skirt, other than the nether limbs showing, is that because of the tight lacing in the bodice and the big skirt, illicit pregnancies could be concealed. So that was one concern. The safety issues weren't anything. There was very little outcry about that. Thank you. You're off the hook. Now, I'd next like to ask Kathy Lynch to step up here. She's wearing a typical nightgown and bonnet from the 1870s. The nightgown is actually from the 1870s. It was part of a trousseau that belonged to a family in Petersham. The baby doll, which is my daughter's doll, Bonnie Babe, that's an antique doll, but she's wearing a baby's outfit. She's life-size. And that is really what children would have worn. There are multiple layers underneath that. Children had their bellies bound so that the belly buttons wouldn't protrude, presumably. And they were not allowed to have the freedom of movement children have today. Okay, we'll let you sit down now. These are children's clothing styles from the 1850s, 1860s period. As I said, there was one other garment that contributed greatly to the discomfort and self-mutilation, if you will, of women in the 19th century, and that's the corset, which I'll turn it this way, it's much easier to see. These are children's corsets. Over here, you see the baby corset. That would have been put on a child of maybe the age of 2. And then you have the 4-year-old model, which would have been worn right up until puberty. And then you have the young teenage girl model, and then you have the woman's model. And what happened was their ribs never grew the way they should, because all their lives they were unable to take a good deep breath. So as a result, you had women like Lily Langtree. Notice her waist. If you can see that picture, it's very, very tiny. And this is a woman who had to project from a stage without benefit of amplification. So she must have, in spite of that, somewhere along the line, her lungs were in there somewhere, but they just weren't in the right place. Okay. In spite of all of this, these constricting clothing and all that, women still did manage to do things. This is a picture taken in 1885. I had one that was a little bit earlier, but it didn't come out as well, so I'm using this one. Notice the women in the large dresses, the bustles, the trains, the parasols to protect their complexions. This was taken on a glacier, in Switzerland, in 1885. They're walking along on the glacier. If you could imagine that, in spite of the corsets and all of that, they still managed to have active lives. The corsets and all of that was also a kind of a subtle form of classism. only the very, very poor didn't wear corsets. Even Ma Ingalls in the Little House books, those of you that are familiar with those books will remember that Laura was chastised by her mother for taking her corset off when she went to bed. Her sister Mary never did that because Mary was a dutiful girl and very stylish, and she wore hers to bed. Laura also took hers off when she went haying with her father, and her mother was horrified about that. This is a typical working pioneer woman's outfit of any time from 1870 up to the early 1900s. It's just a very basic outfit. Jeanette is fortunate she's not wearing a corset underneath the dress, but if she were a young woman with any social pretensions or with parents with any social pretensions, she would have been. She's also carrying an iron, which I'd like her, if she is up for it, to walk around and let people hold that. Now, this iron would have been used to iron the clothing that she has in there. Show them the drawers. Classic pair of drawers from the 1870s or so. Very fancy. Imagine washing and ironing those. Take my word for it. With an electric iron, it takes me almost 40 minutes to iron those properly. Imagine having to heat those irons up on a hot wood stove, wearing all of these clothes on a summer day, only to do it again the following week, over and over again. Let them hold the iron. Now, Marjorie, I never did get to you. This is my daughter, Marjorie. I could never impose on anyone else to do this except the child. She's being paid. This is a corset. It's not as bad as some, but it's, I'm sure, very uncomfortable. She also is thin. She's young. But this would have been something that even someone my age would have been forced to wear. And if you ever look at those old photographs and you see these women who have jowls, and they have shoulders, and they have arms, and then they have waists like this, you can just imagine how uncomfortable they were. This chemise that she's wearing is from the 1850s. The shoulder line is a good indicator for that, because dresses were very off the shoulder at that time. Even a day dress might have the same line, but then it would have this piece of cloth that would come in, kind of on the idea of the collar on Kristen's dress. Thank you, Marjorie. You can show them the tongs. She has curling irons. Now the next, those are curling irons. Marge, you can show them, take them around. Yeah, you'd heat them up in the fire and hope they weren't too hot so you didn't burn your hair. That's how the bangs became popular in the front. People were curling their hair and they'd burn the front of their hair, so they wound up with these frizzy bangs. They were very popular in the 1880s. Speaking of which, this is a classic profile, or silhouette, I should say, of an 1880s woman, taken in 1889. The big wide skirt has given way to the bustle around the back. There was a transitional period in between the two where the dress was a bit fuller in the front and you wound up with this very long train. But I didn't feel up to making someone wear something like that. I do have a skirt from that period, but it's really difficult to walk in because it wraps around your ankles. And all I could imagine is walking through a house with all the bric-a-brac that people had back then, and you're trailing 2 yards of cloth behind you, and it tangles up and gets wrapped around things. It'd be very uncomfortable. This is considered sort of a country outfit. This isn't a fancy dress outfit. And we have someone here today, Sam, who is wearing a dress with a bustle. And it's a, believe it or not, a riding dress. This is what someone might have worn riding a horse. If it was a bit fancier, then it would be more of a walking dress. But take Sam's word for it. It's not easy to walk around in. This particular bustle is just padding. But there were bustles that were like cages, very similar to the hoop skirt, but of a different shape. And plus, you could tighten them up. They had these little tabs on the side where you could lengthen or shorten. You could loosen or widen the skirt as you chose. So they were kind of, in a way, one size fits all. They were just like cages, though. Corsets and hoop skirts were made of whalebone, but later they went into metal because metal was easier to obtain and didn't break as readily. Now, (clears throat) There were people who were social reformers. I wouldn't want you to think that people all meekly went off to the slaughter wearing these clothes. There were women who stood up and tried. Of course, everyone knows about Amelia Bloomer and how she was taunted for wanting to have rational dress, and she wore bloomers and a skirt. A dress, in fact, very similar to this one that Dr. Mary Walker is wearing. But Dr. Mary Walker went one step farther, and rather than bloomers, you see she has trouser legs and her hair is down, which was considered very risque for the time. But she, certainly her outfit would be much easier to make rounds as a country doctor, much easier. And another movement, which really, pardon me? Amelia Bloomer? Amelia Bloomer was in the 1840s. She was earlier, and she wanted people to not wear these long, big, you know, voluminous clothes. Plus, in the 1840s, before the hoop skirt was invented, people would wear up to 14 petticoats starched to hold their dresses out. That's a lot of weight, and it makes it very cumbersome, and not to mention a lot of work trying to maintain those clothes. So she felt that, you know, this was absurd, and so she advocated for dress reform. And so she devised this garment that was very much like the dresses of the 1840s, with the similar line in the shoulders and, of course, still cinched in a bit in the waist. But the skirt was shorter, and they had bloomer legs, kind of like what we would think of harem pants underneath. But you know what it is, social pressure put on people. No one wants to be that different, and no one wanted to wear the clothes, so they didn't. Another group of people were the Pre-Raphaelites, primarily in England. I sort of hesitated to use them, and in most books they are used as examples of dress reform. They really weren't reformers. They were just saying they liked the style of the Renaissance, which was the longer flowing, or actually even pre-Renaissance style. They really had some rather odd ideas about women, and they fed into that sort of cult of the sick woman. So I just wanted to show this picture. This is Jane Morris. She was the wife of William Morris, and she didn't wear hoop skirts as often. I would like to have Mara Shulman come up, if she wouldn't mind. Mara's wearing a maternity outfit, which is kind of strange to put Mara in this outfit. I got this outfit from a woman. It's from about 1875 to 1880. And I looked at it. The waist on the skirt was huge. I mean, it fit me. I was amazed. But the jacket, if you notice, the shoulders are very tiny. It's very small. And notice how the front of it kind of comes out. If you want to hold that out a tad more, you can see it comes out. That was made for a pregnant woman to wear. And then she could adjust the skirt and make it smaller later on. That's the first maternity outfit I've ever gotten in any of the clothes that I bought. You just don't find them as a rule, or else maybe people made them over. For some reason, this one was saved. She's also wearing a mourning veil. That would have been worn if you were in mourning. Women spent a great deal of their time in mourning. People died a lot earlier in the old days, from sickness, children, and husbands, and family members. So a good black silk dress was something that most women had. In fact, a lot of women wore them for wedding dresses even. If you're, again, familiar with Laura Ingalls Wilder, she wore a two-piece black silk dress when she got married. Very similar, you can sit up, very similar to the one that Laura Moore is wearing. This type of a dress would have been worn even in the summer. I know it's hard to imagine in the heat, with a corset, two petticoats, a chemise, a corset cover, stockings, lace-up shoes, and a two-piece black silk dress, and a hat. I suppose this is from the 1890s. Laura should be grateful if she had lived, if she was modeling an outfit of an earlier time, she probably would have, by rights, had to have worn a cloak of some sort, because most women did not leave the house without some sort of a cloak. It was just, you weren't considered dressed. The overhead that you see here is of Queen Louise of Denmark and her grandchildren. But notice underneath it says Athens, that's as in Greece, August 1882. And they're in a train car with no air conditioning, no electric fans, and look at what they're wearing. Those poor children, they have on stockings, and they have on lace-up shoes. Also at this time, people believed that wool was healthier to wear against your skin than cotton, and that it would breathe better. So a lot of times, children would literally die of heat exhaustion. Young children who couldn't verbalize how uncomfortable they were, babies who became fretful and cried. They used to call it summer complaint. Oftentimes it was just heat exhaustion or staph infections that would occur because of the rubbing of the wool against the skin. It's definitely a very uncomfortable period to be a child. Okay, you can sit down. But there were better days coming. Believe it or not, yeah. This is an interesting picture here, taken in the 1890s. It shows two outfits, which we have here. We have, come on, yeah, both of you. Yeah, Sholi. And we also have a lovely wool skirt, walking outfit, considered the acme of comfort and convenience from the 1890s. And this is a bicycling outfit. And another thing to notice in this photograph, these young women are walking along unescorted. They have the, of course, there's the two of them together, but still they're unescorted. And they're out enjoying themselves and having a great deal more freedom of movement. And finally, this is a scene in Coney Island, New York, 1899. You can ham it up. Here we have our bathing beauty, Corey, wearing a wool bathing suit, mind you. This is wool. Yes, it's wool. Yeah, you can go around and let them feel if they don't believe. The stockings are also old. They would have been really worn. And that type of shoe is what one would wear to the beach, swimming in the water. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yep. Well, it's interesting that so much change could have occurred in the space of 50 years, because that's really all we've talked about is 50 years, from Kristen's dress to Corey's bathing suit to the walking outfit and the bicycling outfit. It really was a time of great change. And it carried over, of course, into the early part of the 20th century, into the teens, when women lost the corset and gained a high waist and much more freedom of movement. World War I occurred. Women went and got jobs. And we know the rest. But this was a pretty interesting period in history if you look at it through the clothes. And it's one way of studying the times, particularly with women, because women didn't really have an awful lot of influence at that time in the greater sphere. Their sphere was at home. Well, thank you. Oh. Oh. I am so sorry. Anita. I know it. This young woman is so nice. I am so grateful to her. She is wearing a corset to wear this dress. This is a copy of a dress that was worn by the Duchess of Connaught in 1894. 2 years ago, I was invited to go to a centennial ball at Belcourt Castle, and we all had to dress in the style of 1894. So I made this dress. The lace is old. The cloth, of course, is not. It would have been silk, and the silk wouldn't have held up. So I felt that it would be wiser to just make a reproduction. Thank you, Anita. I'm really sorry. Okay. Okay, everybody, come on out. Oh, that's what I was thinking. That's why I was trying to be shorter, uncharacteristically so. Yes. They're like blinders, I know. That was to protect your skin from the sun. It was not a good thing to have freckles or to have a tan. And there's, of course, now we know a tad bit of wisdom in that, but not quite to this extent. It would be very hard to really function with a hat like that. Certainly kept you focused on your activity at hand. Yes? That's beautiful. Oh, that's lovely. I'd come over there, but I'm attached to this. Yeah, boys wore dresses until they were probably seven or so, six or seven. Oh, absolutely. They also would have probably had something wool underneath that, too. That has, you can just imagine, you know how babies thrash around. Poor little things would get tangled up in that, and it would just be so uncomfortable.
I had recently gal wore a corset like that so much, she went to bed with it, and then when they took it off, she flopped down from the waist because all the muscles that held her back were all useless.
I wouldn't be surprised, because when people put rings on their necks, another type of self-mutilation, you know, they're supposedly they would suffocate. I don't know. I've heard that. Yes? No. No. Yes. Yes. Yeah. It was a lot of work. And I always used to, when we have a scrub board at home that belonged to my husband's grandmother. Yeah, I had to stop and think for a minute if it was his great-grandmother. It was his grandmother's. And she still did her laundry that way. And I look at that and I think, my God. And the way they were dressed, having to hook your skirt up and tuck it in your waist, and you're all laced up and you're trying to, you know, do that and everything else with things cooking on the stove probably. I mean, multiple tasks at the same time. It's just hard to imagine. Yes?
I came a little late, so you may have talked about this at the beginning, but were there big differences in class?
Only in the very lowest of classes. Pioneer women and extremely poor women would have worn an outfit similar to what Jeanette is wearing. Most people did wear hoop skirts. I was surprised myself when I found that out, but I had an overhead that showed women who worked in shops wearing hoop skirts. Everyone did, and you just had to work around it. I was thinking, how, if you lived in Paris, like that photograph was of Paris, sidling down stairways, you know, from your apartment or your rooms with your skirt up, and it must have been so difficult. It's hard to imagine just maneuvering on a daily basis like that. Sir. Anyone else with any questions? Yes?
What were the catalysts for the rapid change that you pointed out? The changes that we've been having. So can you identify some of the factors for the change?
It's really hard to say. I'm tempted to think that it might have been the women's movement and the striving for reform and the fact that the clothes are just so darned uncomfortable. And also, too, if you have a situation where women have such low self-esteem that they define themselves by their appearance and all of that, eventually people get better. You know, I don't know, though. I think you could probably have 50 people in a room and they'd all have a different idea about why.
Well, are we looking at clothes that were primarily worn in the United States or
Europe? United States and Europe. Yeah. Somewhat, yes. Probably quicker in this country because of the movement west. Women probably were more inclined to consider comfort. But then again, like I said, pioneer women wore corsets. Underneath those dresses, they wore corsets. So. Yes? Oh, my dress. This is from the 1890s. This is called a leg of mutton sleeve. And normally it would be a bit fluffier, but it was in a suitcase all night, so it's kind of not. I made this. This is a reproduction out of antique cloth. It's very hard to find cotton clothes that are printed at times in good enough shape to wear, because people would cut them up. People were very thrifty. They would use them to cut the skirt down and make a child's outfit or a quilt or something like that. You're more apt to find silk, and then again, unfortunately, the silk is usually not in very good shape. But this is typical 1890s. I wore this in a play a couple years ago. Yes? African American women, when they were slaves, dressed like Jeanette. However, once they gained their freedom, and if they had jobs, or if they received education or aspired to that, they would have fed into that too. African American women also wore corsets. It's something that, unfortunately, most women in the 19th century really did do. Any other questions? Well. It's her underwear. Oh yes, that's what went on underneath the hoop skirt. Yeah. Yes.
I'd like to ask this question. When they did get together, they make whooping. What happened to the bowls?
Well, who has on the split drawers? Yeah, we have this really, I can tell the story, my grandmother's dead. Her mother was never seen naked by her husband, ever. And you notice the split drawer. Oh, you took the corset off, good girl. Yeah, there you go. Well, I guess then if there are no other questions, some of these people are probably very anxious to get undressed.